Good morning, everybody. Welcome. We're glad you're here at the Texas Public Policy Orientation's 14th annual orientation for the Texas Legislature, and particularly glad you're here with us today at the Center for Economic Freedom's panel on corporate subsidies and corporate welfare. This is an issue of a lot of discussion has been going on about corporate welfare, corporate subsidies, economic development. There's a lot of different ways to describe it, and you'll hear a variety of views on that today. When we look at Texas today, we really see what is the what everybody considers to be the nation's leading economy. By the way, my name is Bill Peacock. I'm with the Center for Economic Freedom at the Texas Public Policy Foundation, so I'll introduce the rest of our guests here in just a moment. When you look at the Texas today, you see really what everybody considers the nation's leading economy. We have led the nation in job creation for many, many years. You look at 2000 to 2010, Texas created more jobs than the entire rest of the country combined. Matter of fact, when we got towards the end of the Great Recession, it was Texas and Texas alone that was keeping the nation employed and keeping us from falling into a great trough on jobs as well as everything else. And there's a reason for that. The Texas miracle, if you will, came from, in fact, the Texas model. Now, what is the Texas model? Well, at the foundation, we have described it as being low taxes and low spending, low regulation, a sound civil justice system, and less reliance and less involvement of the federal government in Texas's business. We're not really boasting so when we talk about the Texas model down here, because there's nothing new about the Texas model. It's really just the American dream. It's what we've been founded on, and it's what we were given in our Constitution. So it's just the latest iteration of all that. But yet, some people say that's not enough. Some people say that we need more, and we need more because other states are doing things differently. Other states are pushing out their economic development programs. They're doing subsidies, and they're doing tax abatements, and they're doing all kinds of things. And that in order to compete with those other states and keep the jobs here and get more jobs, we need to do some of the same thing that they're doing. And so that's really the discussion we're going to have today here in this panel. Do we need renewable energy subsidies? Do we need local tax abatements? Do we need the Texas Enterprise Fund? Up until recently, we had even the Emerging Technology Fund, where the government actually went out and purchased or invested in private businesses and did that. Now, that's gone, thankfully, but there's still a lot of other different things that we have to deal with, and we're going to have a discussion today whether we need those things and how much of those things we need to counterbalance what's going on in other states. So our panel is going to discuss that with us today. Our first speaker today is Austin Councilman Don Zimmerman. He represents Austin City Council District 6. He's one of the first batch of the new council members that serve individual districts. Mr. Councilman Zimmerman is best known for his efforts to fight various tax proposals, and not just at the city government level. In 2002, he was elected president of the Northwest Austin Municipal Utility District, number one, where he waged a legal battle against a practice that he maintained was unlawful. Turns out the courts agreed with him because he won when a court sided with the MUD. In that process, the taxpayers in MUD District, that MUD District number one, saved $18 million. And I'm here to tell you today that Councilman Zimmerman is keeping up that fight today for us on Austin City Council. Will you please join me in welcoming Councilman Don Zimmerman?
Well, thank you, Mr. Peacock, for that, and thank you all for having me here today. Let me say first, I want to commend the work the TPPF does. I attended my first forum back in 2002 in the Driscoll Hotel. And at that time, when this thing first started off, I was astonished at the quality of the research and the academic level that TPPF brought. But after attending a few days, and I think I went back the next year and probably the year after that, the thought finally occurred to me, you know, TPPF can do the greatest research in the world, take it to the policymakers, and they're free to ignore it. So it was around this time I committed myself to saying, you know, TPPF, they've got the policy side covered. They got the research covered. I need to go out and work on campaigns. Try to get myself elected, try to get other people trained, get people involved as precinct chairs, get them in conventions, get them networking, get people in office so that when TPPF brings in the research and says, look how this makes sense, we would have rational people that would listen and vote accordingly. So that's kind of the path that I took, but I've been very grateful for the work that the Policy Foundation has been doing. I'm just going to make a couple of comments quickly. One of the battles we had right off in my first year of being on council was, of course, the budget cycle. And as part of the budget cycle, we had to talk about Austin's economic development department. And some of you may not know this, but the economic development department actually started in around 2000 when Kirk Watson, the senator, was the mayor of Austin. And it's interesting, we researched this. It's hard to get information out of city government, but we eventually found out the way it started was somebody slipped in a budget amendment kind of from the dais, and they created this group of people that were going to work on economic development, and it started off with $25,000, $50,000. So they just kind of slipped it in, and you know the rest of the story. As the years go by, it morphs into its own bureaucracy. Now it spends millions of dollars and controls tens of millions more. And one of the points I made when we had these budget meetings, I said to the economic development director, Mr. Kevin Johns, I said, you know, we could abolish your entire department and we would have economic development in Austin. And the reason I know that is because the city was founded in about 1839, and from 1839 up to 2000, we had economic development when you didn't exist. And we could lay off every one of you, and I would say in my northwest section of the city, northwest Austin, nobody would know that you ever existed. They didn't take that very kindly, but it was the truth, and it remains the truth. So I'm going to go ahead and make my remarks real short. There's some people here that know a lot more than I do, and hopefully we can open this up for Q&A. I've discovered the most fun part about my job here in Austin is live questioning and answering, because every time I do a town hall meeting, somebody will come in and challenge me on economic development. One of the last challenges I got, Economic Development Department has underneath it something about cultural arts. I still don't understand what it is. I ask bureaucrats questions all the time. They talk, and it makes no sense. So that's one of the issues I have on the council. I'm an engineer in my training and professional work, so I made a living out of being precise, being exact, making objective measurements, and taking the gray and discerning it into black and white. The city works in the opposite way. They take what's true and what's false and what's black and what's white, and they merge it into gray. And the reason they make things gray is because if there's no right or wrong, they're free to do anything they wish. So that's the way the city works. So with that, I'll listen to my colleagues, and hopefully we'll get some interesting questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Don. Our next speaker today is Chris Wallace. Chris is the president of the Texas Association of Business, which is based in the State Chamber of Commerce. In this role, Chris manages the TAB's statewide team responsible for strategy, operations, membership, marketing, as well as the board and chamber relations. Prior to joining the Texas Association of Business, Chris was the president and CEO of the Greater Irving Las Colinas Chamber. So he's bringing both a local look at this issue, but also now in Austin, bringing a statewide look at the programs at both levels. And we're really glad to have him here with us today. Please join me in welcoming Chris Wallace.
Thank you, Bill, and good morning. TAB certainly appreciates the great partnership we have with TPPF, and I appreciate the invitation. I'm honored to serve on a great panel with the senator and the councilman, and look forward to our dialogue. Good morning to each of you, and welcome. We have several business leaders in the room. One of our past chairwomen, Gray Mays from TI, is here, and several others. And you know, at TAB, and for as the voice of business in this great state, we seek a Texas to sustain a Texas that has a public policy climate that supports sustained economic growth. A public policy climate that supports a sustained economic growth. And to do that, we've got to have the tools in place necessary to be able to support our economic sustainable growth. That includes incentives. Incentives, economic development incentives, are not the whole picture, but they are part of the picture. They are part of the equation that makes successful economic development deals. As Bill said, I led the Irving Los Colinas Chamber for 10 years, and they actually do the economic development for the city, one of the most vibrant economic development entities in the entire state. And incentives got us over the goal line. They were a part of the deal, but a very important part of the deal. And as Bill pointed out in his introduction earlier, was that is the game that other states are playing. And we got to remain competitive and play the game. You know, businesses seek that we have a climate that is sustainable in terms of economic growth. And as I mentioned, there are components of that, of the tools in place. We've got to have the recruitment. We've got to have the more State Farm insurance. We've got to have more Toyotas. And the list goes on and on. We've got to have more retention and do a better job at retaining our businesses from those states that are here each and every day trying to steal our businesses to go to their states. And of course, we've got to have expansion. A piece that often gets lost is the expansion. And that's where the net jobs are today. So the Apples of the world right here in Austin that are looking at huge expansion projects, we've got to have more of those. We've got to have more Facebooks that are going to be adding the most jobs to make Facebook the largest, second largest footprint in the entire world right here in the great state of Texas. 63% of our tax base comes from businesses. 63% of our tax base in this great state comes from business. So recruitment, retention, and expansion are key to maintaining our corporate tax base, keeps our citizens' taxes low because the businesses bear the brunt of the taxes through their property and sales tax, right? And of course, yes, we are all very proud and very blessed to live in Texas where we have a low state income tax. We have no state income tax. We have a low tax structure, no state income tax for our employees. We have balanced regulation, considering we have balanced regulation. We've got some tweaks here and there that we can do. Had a great session this last legislative session of balanced regulation. We have competitive housing markets all across the state. We have a predictable civil justice system, which most states cannot vouch for today. And of course, we have great access. I like to tout that. We are in the central time zone. So an executive can be in his or her house with his or her family members from traveling on the West Coast or East Coast, be back in their house the very same day because where we have access of our national, international airport system right here in Texas. So we have a lot going for us as a state. Some of the top economic development publications continue to rate Texas 1, 2, 3, typically 1 or 2 in the top states in which to do business, polled by several of our nation's CEOs. We continue to attract middle and high-wage jobs, not just the low-wage jobs, but middle to high-wage jobs at a faster pace than any other state in the entire country, at a faster pace than any other state in the entire country. And, of course, we're home to, 54 Fortune 500 companies. So how did we get here? We got here through sensible economic development, through a process that makes sense with incentives to allow us to be competitive, to play the game that other states, the North Carolinas, the South Carolinas, the Tennessees, the Alabamas, the Louisianas, our top competitors are playing today, and others that are catching up with us, the New Yorks of the world. Incentives are very important. They are a part of the deal. But again, we must have transparency. We must have greater accountability because we're dealing with taxpayers, all of our dollars, to help incentivize new jobs, mid-level to higher wage jobs for Texans, our fellow Texans. We must maintain our very top status as a state. The assets that I mentioned, plus the tools that we'll hopefully get in on this dialogue today, will help us to remain competitive. Because, you know, it's no secret, we've got a major shift of demographics that are underway. So we must do a better job of preparing our next generation of workers, education has to remain a key component. And that's part of an economic development deal, where their kids go to school, what the future talent and workforce looks for. You know, companies, it's no secret, companies are looking for today three things: talent, infrastructure meaning technology, transportation, water, which we're doing a very good job at thus far, and lastly, capital. Talent, infrastructure, capital. Anything that we can do to incentivize them to invest in our state, to do greater, to do more good. Let me just give you a quick example. I know I'm running out of time. Many economic development corporations, cities, chambers of commerce around the state conduct annual economic impact analyses. The one conducted in North Texas just a few years back, for every dollar of government spending in terms of incentives, there was $4,286 in economic activity in terms of the output, $1,658 in wages and income, $355 in retail spending, $42 for every $1, $42 in property tax, that's city tax and the ISD tax, $4.3 in local sales tax for every dollar spent. Now, what the impact graded, the criteria were jobs, new jobs, investment into the community, into the state, employee spending. We often forget about that. What's the ancillary benefit? The employees that move here, the employees that are hired, that are earning higher wages, what they spend in the economy, and of course, the tax revenue to our government systems, which is very much needed. So that's just one example of the economic impact that incentives in our economic development system, which we're so successful at, as Bill pointed out, all across this great country, Texas continues to shine. So whether it be moving Fluor Corporation from Southern California, whether it be moving health management systems from New York to North Texas, there's a lot of economic activity going on throughout the state, and we must continue that. Now, granted, we've got to have clawbacks in place, because we want to make sure that taxpayer money is protected. But the key goals of today, the outcomes that we hope at TAB and all of our partners, chambers of commerce, economic developers, several are in this room today, that we hope that you will leave with today, or let me just give you these 6 points. One, to keep us competitive in Texas, we've got to have skills development training. Two, we've got to support entrepreneurs and small businesses. That is the core of any state economy, particularly here in Texas. Invest in world-class research. Invest in world-class research. The governor's research initiative this last session. Promote quality and competition in public and higher education to prepare Gray's future workers at TI and your future workers throughout the entire state. You got to have that talent. That's the number one criteria, right? Provide state and local incentives to compete for corporate expansions and relocations. This adds jobs for fellow Texans. This keeps us competitive as a state. It keeps our citizens' taxes low when we have more taxes coming into the state on the corporate side. And of course, exempt businesses, the most that we can get in terms of taxes. We did a pretty good job in terms of franchise tax this last session. But what can we do about BPP, business, personal property, or inventory tax, which we're one of the only states that still have the inventory tax? Thank you for your time this morning. I'm running out of time, and I look forward to our dialogue.
Thank you very much, Chris. Appreciate it. Our last speaker this morning is Senator Konni Burton. She represents District 10. The Texas Senate out of Fort Worth and Tarrant County. She's in her first term in the Texas legislature, and during the 84th legislature, Senator Burton served on the Higher Education, the Nominations, and the Criminal Justice Committees, and was also appointed vice chair of the Veteran Affairs and Military Installations Committee. Senator Burton worked closely with all legislators in ensuring that our rights as Texans and Americans were being respected while promoting fiscally responsible, constitutionally sound bills to the Texas legislature. She also is doing a great work here in the Texas legislature protecting our rights, like Councilman Zimmerman. She may have a little more help than Don does in the Austin City Council, but she's doing a great job up here, and we're welcome, glad to have her here. Please join me in welcoming her.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Appreciate being here. This is definitely a topic for me. It's my passion, kind of a lot of why I'm an elected, why I got into politics, I should say. Let me see if I can do this right. There we go. Just we have a little bit of a prezi here, so you don't have to stare at me. You can stare up there at what we've got, and just a little bit of an outline of what I'm going to talk to you about. First and foremost, a quote from Milton Friedman. Underlying most arguments against the free market is a lack of belief in freedom itself. And freedom is something I believe strongly in. And the free market is something that I believe strongly in. And just to kind of start off, let's get back to what the free market is and what the definition of that is. And that is a simple one, is an economic market system, an economic market or system in which prices are based on competition among private businesses and not government. Government at all levels are choosing to subsidize some businesses, maybe via cash payments, tax abatements, or anti-competitive regulations, because of their size or their product or service that they provide. And what is happening when they do that is we create an unlevel playing field for this competition, which is what the free market is based on. So let me just make it very simple. We give companies money to come into our state. And what happens is this particular company could have the same product or service as a company that has been in our state from the get-go, a mom-and-pop organization that started their business on their own with a sweat of their brow, and they've got this company that's doing well, and now the state of Texas has gone outside the state and said, hey, we've got some taxpayer dollars, by the way, for you. Come on into our state. It's great. It's a great place to be. So we know that businesses can provide that how they price a product or a service is based on their fixed costs, right? So if we've now given this company from out of state to come in here, we've given them some money to come, we've reduced their costs. Now they have less costs than this company that has always been here, that has started from the ground, Texans that have fought, you know, that have fought hard to create this business. Now they can sell this product or their service for less money than the people who have always been here and started their business from scratch. We are creating an unlevel playing field in the free market by giving your taxpayer dollars to a particular company, and that's wrong. And ultimately, it makes the big companies bigger, and it makes it harder for these small businesses to succeed, because it is the big businesses, I promise you, that are getting these incentives. Capitalism is the only sustainable means of elevating a population's standard of living, and capitalism works best when buyers and sellers determine prices. That's how the market works. Government subsidies interfere with the market, determining the value of those products. Also, consumers can quickly decide to stop buying or investing in a company or product when it stops being of value. That's the way it's supposed to work. A company then goes out of business if their product or service is no longer wanted. Unfortunately, when governments get involved, they are in for the long haul. Think ethanol, wind, solar subsidies, ethanol, wind, and solar subsidies. Most of the incentives designed to lure businesses to an area include many-year contracts. So when a product or service is failing and it's getting government money, generally the government gives it more money, is how it fixes it, instead of allowing that business to go out of business. Businesses also become dependent on political connections to help them compete rather than being forced to rely on continued innovation. It makes me nuts when people, when lobbyists, and I don't bemoan all lobbyists. I want to see lobbyists to help me to explain a particular industry, or help me to know how a regulation is hurting them, or how taxes are hurting them. But when they come in and they are looking to government to protect their industry, instead of them figuring out a way to better market their product, it drives me nuts. Think taxis in competition with Uber. Perfect example, right?
Yep.
And that's it. So trust me, it goes on, and you all know it based on your snickers. Let me see here. I've got another. Let's go to the next slide. Oops, I had forgotten the. I already forgot that. That was that right there, distortion of the free market. Now we'll go on to myths of the benefits. So there's myths about it helping citizens. So the amount of government-funded infrastructure that is needed is determined by the size of a population. Politicians tell us that luring big businesses in with incentives spreads the cost of government over a bigger tax base, thereby reducing each taxpayer's burden. If this were true, rural areas would have higher taxes than urban areas, and quite the opposite is true. Infusions of populations puts a strain on infrastructure, which requires the need for more government spending to deal with overcrowding, such as schools, roads, water, etc. But it has less tax dollars per capita to pay for them. Central planners, and that is what government does best, central plan, have a bad track record of funding businesses. Have a bad track record of funding business enterprises that don't deliver the promised return, and citizens have no choice whether or not to participate. Examples: Formula One racing, Super Bowls, and the latest WrestleMania. I keep forgetting to do the. The next one is the corruption of the political process. The purpose of taxes is to fund core functions of government, not to become intertwined with big business. The more that public money is available to businesses, the bigger the lobby gets and the more it influences public policy. Politicians use pictures of themselves with hard hats and shiny shovels to help insulate themselves from challengers to their office, thereby helping to create career politicians. And a distracted government. These kinds of things distracts government from the core functions. When governments negotiate with other people's money, the deals can and do get progressively worse. For instance, Facebook data center that just came into my area got $150 million for adding 40 jobs. So when we do this, we divert funding from schools, roads, etc. And let me just interject right here. We hear a lot about competition, and this is Republicans' fault. Republicans talk about it all the time in terms of government and competition. Listen, competition is fantastic. I love competition in the private industry. That's what gets people to innovate and create and be better at their product or their service. This is what you do in a business. You market it. You figure out what's better and how to, you know, what kind of angle you can go at to get more of the consumer's money. But competition in government is wrong. When a government starts, what do we care? What do bureaucrats care when they're competing with your tax dollars? It doesn't mean anything to them for the most part. They'll say, yeah, we'll give you a bigger this or we'll give you a bigger that. So I would really caution everybody to stop using that term competition with government. In the private industry, great. It's their money. If they fail, they go out of business. Again, if government bureaucrats compete, they're competing with your tax dollars. And this is the wrong direction. Government programs require more government oversight, as was mentioned earlier, right? We need oversight. You want transparency. I believe in transparency. But when you need this transparency, you need more oversight and administration, which fuels government's need to grow. The larger government gets, the more duplicative, inefficient, and distracted it becomes. And pretty soon, we aren't paying enough attention to the core functions of state government, which is education, roads, public safety, water infrastructure, and unfortunately these days, border security. I just want to finish with this. The role, let's get back to what the role of government and what the role of the free market is. The role of government is to protect the rights of its citizens. That's what the role of government is. When we start labeling, when we start saying that the number of jobs created, how can we say that government doesn't create jobs, which it doesn't, and then we use number of jobs created as a barometer? That doesn't make sense. We need to quit doing that, and we need to talk about creating an environment that allows people to be creative, to be entrepreneurs. They're the ones that create the jobs. Let them do that, and let's stick to what we're supposed to be doing. We have a state that has, we are blessed with a state that has natural resources. We have no income tax. We need to keep taxes low, keep regulations low, keep our great tort system, and let people be entrepreneurs. Let's focus on people being entrepreneurs and marketing their business based on supply and demand, not based on bureaucrats in an office determining using your money to give to particular businesses that will only make it worse in the end. This competition that we must compete with other states is ridiculous. It's ridiculous. All it does, as I said and mentioned before, is we're going to have businesses keep, certain businesses just keep getting bigger, and they're going to be, and the small businesses are not going to be able to compete with them. What we want are small businesses, entrepreneurs, to compete in the free market and let government really get out of the way. Don't just use the term get out of the way and then give business money. Really get out of the way and let the free market work. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Senator. Appreciate you being here. We're going to get to Q&A in a little bit, so if y'all have some questions, please be thinking of them. In the meantime, I'd just like to ask the panel if y'all have some more ideas or thoughts or questions for each other you'd like to share.
I'll go first.
Sure.
2 minutes, maybe.
We've got plenty of time.
Let me start first by saying I'm glad I limited my comments, because I think we've got two experts here that are ready to go at it. I want to commend Mr. Wallace for highlighting the points that I hear practically on a weekly basis with companies and lobbyists and what have you coming into the city council asking for various types of incentive deals. And I think Mr. Wallace laid out the arguments that I hear on a daily basis almost very, very well. Then we had Senator Burton that I think accurately reflects my view of the policy. So I almost felt like stepping back and watching a policy smackdown go on right here. But let me back up and take a little different tact and talk about the politics of the matter in elections. I was involved in a very competitive city council election in 2014. As many of you know, we went to 10 geographic districts. Now, there's an inside joke on this. They say that the 10 won, you know, that Zimmerman's the one and there's 10 others, you know, because I lose votes 10 to 1 all the time. But it was a very, very competitive race. And I ended up in a runoff in first place, and my opponent was a very well-connected Democrat, very articulate, very well-funded, very hard-working. He did about as good a job advocating the city party line as anyone we could find. But we made an issue in the campaign about corporate incentives, and we especially brought up the Apple incentive package. And I can tell you from knocking on doors and talking to voters, your average informed voter is incensed over these incentives, especially Apple computer. To think that to think that the richest corporation in the history of the world needs your tax money. And at the small business, as Senator Burton pointed out, the homegrown businesses and the people here that have been shouldering the load, that they're going to have to shoulder even more tax burden and suffer the problems of explosive growth for the benefit of the world's richest corporation. It was crazy to me in terms of the so-called Democrat progressive message, which is the rich aren't paying their fair share. It caused such a dissonance, a cognitive dissonance, to have these Democrats saying, oh, the rich aren't paying their fair share, but we're subsidizing the world's richest corporation. That cognitive dissonance was astonishing. So my opponent got caught out a little bit on that and tried to follow my line. Yeah, incentives are a bad deal. The problem for him was, as the president of the Gay Lesbian Chamber of Commerce, he testified to City Hall that we should approve the Apple corporate incentives. And we had that on tape. So that helped our campaign. And so when the voters said, well, wait a minute, you know, Zimmerman's opponent stood in front of the Austin City Council advocating in favor of the Apple corporate incentives. So that helped me to win the election. So I think from a political viewpoint, what I want to say to voters and potential candidates, it is a winning issue to go out and point out to voters, you know what, we want to defend you, create this level playing field, stop these corporate incentives. We had economic growth in this country before any of these policies existed. I also want to underscore what Senator Burton said about the bureaucratic situation in this country. I personally believe that if you look at what's happened with the Veterans Administration, all the way down to my own Economic Development Department in the city, there is a growing disconnect between elected officials and the government bureaucracies. It is really remarkable what's happening. And I think some of these departments are going out, and they're on autopilot. And like she said, they think of themselves as competing against other bureaucrats in other cities and states, and that is a dangerous thing for us as taxpayers. And it's hazardous to you as voters, because what good does it do to vote for elected representatives if the bureaucrats just go off and do what they want, irrespective of your vote and what you're asking them to do? So. From a political viewpoint, it is, I think, definitely a winning issue to elect people that are serious about ending these corporate subsidies. So with that, I'll pass it off to my colleagues.
I just wanted to say quickly, too, it's funny because my husband and I are about as, always have been, we've always from the get-go thought of what business to start. We look at all businesses, whether we want to invest in them or not. Excuse me. We're very that way. I'm a marketing student. My husband's a marketing student. And because I'm against corporate subsidies by moderate Republicans and others, I get labeled as anti-business, which is hilarious. So, you know, as you all know, take a deeper look at the mailers that you get and those kinds of things, because I'm actually the one that is pro-business, because I'm for all businesses, not just for some. So just wanted to interject that.
And Senator, thank you for those remarks, and Councilman, you as well. I very much appreciate them, and I know my economic development colleagues do as well. But again, five key points. Skills development and training, support entrepreneurs and small businesses, invest in world-class research, promote quality and competition and graduation rates within public and higher education, provide state, and local incentives to compete for corporate relocations and expansions to add jobs for fellow Texans. Those are the five key points. That is the basis of economic development planning in any state, particularly right here in the great state of Texas. Now, I want to ask a couple questions. I wonder, one, elected officials make the decisions on what the final incentives are to the companies, not staffers. Staffers recommend. They do the research, the due diligence. Elected officials of cities, counties, state sign off on incentives to spur economic development. You know, government does not create jobs. That is correct. Government jumpstarts. They spur economic development for companies, for the private sector to create jobs.
So government has a part of the equation, not certainly the majority of the equation. We still must have a spirit of free enterprise and a free market competition system, which we still do in this great country and in Texas. You know, we're not talking about a lot of money to these companies. I remember when I was in Irving, we're not talking about a lot of taxpayer dollars to spur economic development. And if you think about those figures that I mentioned, I wonder if we were to run an economic impact analysis on a Facebook or an Apple, for every $1 that we have given or incentivized to a company, how many dollars are we putting back in our own wallets of economic activity for the examples listed? I can tell you across the state, as I mentioned, economic development impact studies proven over and over again that for every $1, there are thousands of dollars of economic activity to the local level, to the county level, to the state level. And there's been case after case proven, which is why states are so competitive to move businesses out of Texas, which is why other states are gaining on us in terms of ramping up their incentive programs. And finally, I must say, Bill, that small businesses are so important to our state's economy. That is absolutely correct. But I wonder how many small businesses benefit from corporate relocations. When an Apple expands here, when a health management system moves from New York City to Irving, Texas, when a floor corporation, I know for a fact, moved from Southern California to Irving, Texas, how many small business caterers, the small businesses that help with their grand opening, they pride themselves on shopping local. Matter of fact, many of the incentive contracts that these corporate relocations are required to sign and clawbacks that are in place, very strict accountability clawbacks from these governments around the state that are striking these deals, many of them say that they must shop local, must use our small businesses in the cities across Texas.
Okay, thanks.
That's something to add.
Senator? Go ahead, Senator, we'll get to you.
Do y'all hear, forgive me, but do you hear that central planning there? We need people educated for this. We need these kind of businesses. We need this, you know, that is central planning, my friends. Businesses are created by supply and demand, period. Period. We don't need to, you know, we don't need to decide what businesses are good for you, what kind of education is good for you, what kind of business you could should own. And when you do that more and more, the more money we give to businesses, the more we get involved. That is central planning. That's not what America is about. We're about freedom. That's what we're about. We're about entrepreneurship. We're about you being free to do what you want to do, to create your kind of business, to get the education you want to get. Not central planners thinking this, we need this in this state. How do they know? The market knows what's needed. The market will determine it. And then people will begin to compete, and then that product will become less expensive. Think Apple. I mean, it's so clear. It's so clear. So don't fall into the trap of thinking that central planning is the way we need to go in whatever. I'm starting to hear this a lot in education. Companies are deciding what kind of education kids should have because they need those kind of workers. Maybe those people don't want to go to work for those companies, okay? Let's not forget the basis of our country and that we want people to be free to do what they want to do as far under the law, as far as starting their own business, be as successful as they want or not, just remain a mom and pop. So all of this, when you hear all this talk, just keep, you know, in the back of your mind, is that restricting freedom more? Is that kind of leading us in a direction that we really want to go because some bureaucrat thinks this is the way that your money should be spent? I'm going to let you keep your money and you decide what products or services you want to buy. I'm going to focus on the roads to get you there, your education, in a general education, an overall education. Make sure that we have public safety provided for you so you're free to go and you know that your environment is safe. That's what I want to focus on. And then let the free enterprise system work.
Yeah, thank you. Let me Let me add something here about what happens in Austin. Obviously, each city has different political dynamics, but I do have some expertise on what happens in the city of Austin. And I will tell you how government bureaucrats control the decisions of your city council members. Mr. Wallace mentioned the importance of economic analysis, and these are reports prepared by PhD economists largely. I think it was Mark Twain that famously said there were lies, damn lies, and then statistics.
Right.
But we've gone way beyond that. Now we have lies, damn lies, statistics, and studies.
Yeah,
and so what ends up happening is if I were to ask for a study from PhD economists, and I would say, okay, guys, I want PhD economists, you guys are experts on the numbers, I want you to analyze what happens if we have a corporate subsidy, what happens if we do not have a corporate subsidy, what kind of growth, what kind of taxes, you know, what happens in these alternative viewpoints. We have corporate subsidy, and here's an economic study that says what we think will happen. And here's another study that says, here's the growth we're going to have if we don't have economic subsidies. Now, here's the key. We have lots of economic analysis from the city bureaucrats about the economic growth when we have subsidies. And we're done. So if you think about your elected city council members that have an agenda item of 80 to 100 items per meeting, and we frequently work until 1 o'clock in the morning, how much deliberation is there going to be on whether corporate subsidies are a good idea? What the city staff is going to do is provide you with studies that show what a great idea it is to have corporate subsidies, and they're done. What decision is your city council and your elected representatives going to have when all of the information supports corporate subsidies? And there's no information and no data and no studies that would suggest maybe it's not a good idea. That's how city bureaucrats control elected officials. They do it through selective information and cramping you in a timeline and say, and as Senator Burton said, there's also this implied threat that if you don't vote for the corporate subsidy, you're anti-business. That's a pretty effective attack too. It's very dishonest and disingenuous, but that's what they do. So I beg to differ. As I joked before, I've lost a lot of votes, 10-1 on these economic issues, because all the information supports voting in favor of what the bureaucrats want, and they want to play the game, as Mr. Wallace said, you know, competing with other cities for these, you know, corporate incentives. So I'm here to tell you that I want to ask you, when you go to vote, when you're looking at city council members, state representatives, senators, you know, make sure that you have a firm commitment that they're going to support the free market and not get involved in these corporate subsidies.
Thank you, Councilman.
You know, the bottom line is, as Bill pointed out in the introduction, to remain competitive, we've got to remain in the game. And states are gaining on us. To remain competitive, to remain in that top tier status, to keep companies moving in here, to supply us jobs for fellow Texans, we've got to play the game. Now ask the question, do we want to take the risk? Do we want to take the risk? I'll be anxious for Q&A. I'll ask the audience, do we want to take the risk of not playing the game and see where we fall? Do we really want to take the risk? I think fellow Texans want well-paying jobs. I think fellow Texans want an economic stability environment. And I think Texans want a standard of living that is much, much improved. Now, this is one piece. Reminder of the 5 points that I mentioned. Incentives are one piece of those 5 points to make sure that we have a sustainable economy here in Texas. It's one piece of the overall puzzle of what the senator mentioned of the core issues that we're all focused on, the water, transportation, education. But a tool to supply more jobs for Texans certainly does not hurt, particularly when there's greater accountability as the legislature passed during the last session, and we'll hopefully concentrate on, and we're going to be strong advocates for greater accountability of taxpayer dollars. So as long as there is a return on investment, there's got to be a positive return on investment. The day that there's not a positive return on investment, we do away with them. But today, there is a positive return on investment. It's been proven and proven again all around this country.
Well, this is making my job really easy, right? I just get to stand up here and listen to these panelists have a really good conversation on this. And let me just throw in one question to perhaps the senator and councilman, and then we'll open it up to Q&A. So there's really, I mean, two types of corporate welfare, if you will, or economic development programs.
Right.
There's the direct taxpayer subsidy. We tax somebody, and then we give that money to somebody. Renewable energy subsidies are an example of that. Mm-hmm. There's the other one, which is really, I think, constitutes the majority of economic development funds programs in Texas, which is tax abatements, right? Mm-hmm. Where we say, okay, move your business here or expand your business there, and we're going to give you a tax abatement over 10 years.
Right.
And so that's not as clear a redistribution of funds as the other ones is. The businesses and others would say that, well, we're just giving tax abatements on taxes that wouldn't even exist today. Because these businesses wouldn't be here, this property wouldn't be worth this much, and therefore it's not a redistribution. It's a gain overall. And then at the end of the 10 years, when all this is over, everybody benefits from the taxes that this company brings in. Do y'all have a response to those questions? And you're welcome to jump
Thank
in
you.
As well.
Can I start from the city side? So?
Sure.
So it's a great question, and we get this all the time. The point that I make is anytime you bring in another business, another corporation, more people, whether it be hundreds of people or thousands of people, those people are going to have an expectation of getting city services. And I can guarantee you that the city bureaucracy, they're going to look at this influx of new people that have come from an abatement or whatever the incentive is and says, well, look at the people that are going to be in the city. We need more services. We need more firefighters. We need more police. We need more ambulances. We need this, that, and the other. And so what happens to your budget? Your budget increases. It absolutely increases. Anytime you bring more companies, more business, and there's infrastructure needs. You're going to have to put in some more roads, some more water and wastewater lines, power substations, whatever you might need. So your budget's going up, but your tax revenue is not. Because the taxes have been abated. What does that mean? It means everybody that's already here is going to be paying more. Because the people that come are going to have those services. When somebody calls 911, an ambulance is going to have to go over there and pick them up. And so, you know what's funny? I'm going to say one other quick thing about the incentivizing the middle and high income jobs. This is one of my favorites. Because we have all the time people in the city of Austin wringing their hands about economic segregation. You heard about economic segregation? Economic segregation. Economic segregation, I don't understand how it can be considered a problem. It's a policy of the Economic Development Department. We're going to subsidize middle and high income jobs. Economic segregation is the city's policy, and then they wring their hands that they have a problem. Anyway, I'm going to pass on this. The frustration just gets to me.
Exactly. Isn't that kind of the broken window fallacy, right? We say, oh, well, it wouldn't be here if we didn't get it, if we didn't force it to be here. That's not true. We don't know what would have gone there if we had kept government out of it. So don't fall for that argument either, right? We don't know what would have gone there if we just let things work how it's supposed to. And also, remember, I always go back, always go back, always go back, regardless of what it is. You are reducing the costs for one business so they can sell their product or service for less than a competing business now can. You are changing the free market system. You are not allowing it to be the free market. Always go back to that. Don't go down rabbit holes that they try to put up. When we change the free market system, we've messed everything up.
I don't think that we're forcing. I think that we're given a push. It's a jump start. It is an incentive. Again, it's a part of an overall piece. When you're talking about millions and millions of dollars of a relocation deal, tax abatements, the incentives are a very, very small portion. But it shows that, one, we love them, we want them, we care that they're here, and we're going to do everything we can as local and state elected officials and fellow business leaders to make sure that they're successful. Now let me address tax abatements. They're really an overall small piece. I think we all would agree that, and that they're specific, as Bill pointed out, there's specific time limits on that tax abatement. Now, what about
all the other ancillary type benefits that we're receiving from the companies that are moving here. They're hiring our fellow citizens, wages and income for those citizens spend money. Our housing demand on housing rises. So they're buying homes, they're spending dollars. What about all the retail benefits that they're spending in our stores that we all benefit from for tax dollars? So when we say a business does not pay taxes, does not spend money in the local economy when they move here, although they receive a really minor tax abatement, they're investing a lot more into the economy on a very limited time frame of that tax abatement, which is not always going to be there. So they will be paying taxes into the economy. And we do not. Think about all the businesses that move here that do not get incentives. They don't qualify for incentives. It's a small piece. So we, you know, we see it as a majority, but it's a piece that is needed. It is a piece that is needed.
To say that we need I mean, you proved my point by saying there's so many businesses that move here without the incentives. I'm sorry. Go ahead. I'm going to ask questions.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Mr. Grogan?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Mr. Wallace.
We got a microphone coming up. So.
Mr. Wallace, I want to compliment you for your bravery coming here.
Yeah.
Bravery is going to be tested.
Among friends. Life. Thank you. Yeah, I appreciate it.
Absolutely.
That's the context of this. I'm a long-term and very happy shareholder, but I can tell you, and I'm a chartered financial analyst from analyzing this, my guess is they would have come at Austin anyway if we didn't give them the money. Because when you talk to the people inside the firm, a couple interesting things came out. They need lots of brain power and lots of programmers. And we have more video programming, gaming programmers than just about anybody else in the world right here. There's about 20 blocks north of UT where there's a lot of one-bedroom apartments with three or four guys living in there doing a great job video gaming. So they would have come here anyway, is my view. Also, this is a gay-friendly city. And they, you know, when they were going to leave Palo Alto, that was an important thing because they have a lot of gay and lesbian employees, so we won on that game. So if you put those two things together, then, so they would have come anyway, and I agree with Councilman Zimmerman and Senator Burton's view on that, that we really don't need to take a company with over $200 billion in cash on their balance sheet, more than the U.S. Treasury, not the Treasury's obligations either, and give them money. But I think the real low-hanging fruit here, and this is what's going to get real tough for you, was Formula One.
Mm-hmm.
Because Formula One, I mean, I'm going to choose my words very carefully, but if I understand correctly, there were some elected officials in this city and some bureaucrats in the city who retired during and after that decision process.
Yep.
Some of them bought some really, really nice ranches in Andorrans.
Yep.
And it's hard to do that on a government salary.
Yep.
Okay, so there's some real questions there.
It's the other thing. I'm glad you brought that up.
The company was indicted and found guilty of a number of crimes in Munich, which was one of the ones they got right before Austin.
Mm-hmm.
And we're now spending tens of millions of dollars a year to keep them here, or they're threatening to pull out if you go to Mexico City or whatever. Yep. I'm not sure exactly on those facts, but there was something in the Statesman 2 months ago.
Right.
So I wonder, and I'll just make a comment. It's humorous, but it'll make the point. Once Formula One comes to town, I mean, when they came, the only time we have lots of prostitutes downtown here is when the legislature's in session. and when we have Southwest, and now we have
Formula One. F1.
But there was a gallery.
Yeah. So is this really, you know, we're taking taxpayer dollars to subsidize things that are corruption, crony capitalism? I mean, I think that's the low-hanging fruit, and I'm really interested in your thoughts on that and how we can avoid repetitions of things like that.
I'm glad you brought up the fact that the contributions. That's what I forgot about that aspect of it. I've talked about that for many, many years. And I'm not even accusing anybody of anything. I'm saying it doesn't look good. It doesn't look good when you give incentives to Facebook or Apple, and all of a sudden those elected officials have hefty donations from Facebook or Apple, right? Regardless if it's even if there isn't anything going on there, it doesn't look good. The other thing is, and I know this for a fact, these companies are using these incentives, these packages, purely to get a better package from another state. I mean, these CEOs are not dumb. They're not dumb. They're going to use it. If it's out there, they're going to use it. And I know for a fact, particularly California companies, they are now using what, and probably others, since the other other states are jumping in on this too, but they've used what they get from Texas, the package, to use it against California to stay there. They have no intentions of moving, ever. But now they're just going around and finding the best package they can from another state, and then they say to California elected officials, oh, we're going to get this if you don't give us something better. This is what happens when you compete with the tax with taxpayer dollars, right? So those bureaucrats in California are like, oh, well, we don't have, you know, what, it's just taxpayer dollars. Let's give them something bigger and better because they don't care. It's not the money in their own pocket, right? So companies are using this against states, and that's why the competition is bad in terms of government. And just one quick story, too. I have a friend in the North Texas area, has a manufacturing facility, you know, going to expand it. They're doing great. They're expanding. Their local elected officials came to them and said, hey, you know, state of Texas has got this money that you'll get, you know, when you expand. And he said, well, I don't want it. You know, we were already going to expand. Yeah, but here it is. Go ahead, use this money because you're going to expand and you qualify, so do it. Even though they were going to expand prior to knowing about this, right? I mean, this is what's happening now. In business, you can do that all you want. You know, that's what you should do in business. But we should not do that in government because it's the taxpayer dollars.
Senator?
Thank you very much. Wow, this is a good panel. It's the best one I've been in. Some good points. Mr. Wallace, you made some good points there, many of which can be provided by the free enterprise system of people just recognizing what needs to be done. But I'd also suggest that what has happened is the gun has been fired, the bullet's on its way. We just haven't fallen over yet. And the measure on that is Texas is the second most indebted state in the nation, $332 billion. And if you go talk to any city council, any school district, and say, why are you in debt? And it's the growth. Mm-hmm. We need it because of the people that are moving here. Right. And you take a county like right next to my district up there that is now giving tax abatements 45 years long, tremendous growth, taxes had to raise, being paid by everybody else because of the people coming in. And I would say that if this model of using taxpayer money was working, we wouldn't be in debt the way we are. What we're doing is kind of like if you raise your standard of living by spending more money on your credit card. You know, that's what we're doing. That's exactly what we're doing as a state. And the other piece of this thing, and I'd love to hear your comments on it, is if you were told that there was a legislature who wanted to pass a bill that was going to require your children and your grandchildren to pay your debts, your personal debts when you die, you'd run them out of office, wouldn't you? But that's exactly what our governments at all level are doing, because the debts we have incurred because of this growth that has come about is going to be paid by our children and our grandchildren. And we are going to go down as the first generation of Americans to leave a country worse than what we'd received it. And I'd suggest that government can affect business. It can stimulate business by taxation, elimination, reduction, and regulation reduction. You imagine the businesses it would draw in rather than picking individual winners and losers at the expense of the other businesses if we got rid of the franchise tax altogether. That's if we got rid of the inventory tax altogether, we got rid of the massive regulations that keep an entrepreneur like Uber from growing and providing its services. Just think, you know, technology in one place saved us from the government. Think about your landline at home, those that have one left. It hadn't changed since Alexander Graham Bell first came up with it. But this thing right here, it kept ahead of government regulation because everybody could quite figure out what to regulate in it.
Thank goodness.
it got ahead of it, or we would we'd still be walking around with that 20-pound brick that they first came up with. Mm-hmm. And so I just say that, you know, for government involvement and economic growth of the country, if we put all of our efforts and all the lobbying that comes in, because you're absolutely right, there's a credible amount of time that is wasted with people looking for carve-outs and special things for their business. Let's look at what we can do for the people of Texas in raising the economic growth by reducing regulations and taxing, and get the business community, rather than looking for special things for them, to come and help us do that project. Anyway, there was a question in there, I think.
Thank you, Senator. Right up here in front.
Thank you. Meg Wilson. Mr. Wallace, I have a question for you. In my 30-year career, I've worked with chambers of commerce and state associations that are supposed to be advocates for business. But if you're talking about your five pillars, all I have seen in some chambers is 100% effort at doing relocation. And if they would stop worrying about relocation and worry about business growth and retention and worry about infrastructure and worry about all those other things that they could advocate for their companies, who are their members paying their dues, then everybody would be growing better. But the attention and the amount of time and effort put into, we got to relocate, we got to do the win-lose, the lose-lose, however you want to put it, that those advocacy organizations are doing a disservice to their members by not taking care of their members. What do you think about that?
No, I think you make some very good points, and I totally agree with you on every point. You know, I was guilty of it too in urban. We spent a lot of time on growing the economy, bringing in new companies for new jobs, new investment, new infusion to help the existing companies, to help the existing members. Survey after survey at the chamber that I served for 10 years, that was our number one goal, is they wanted a expanded tax base. They wanted us to bring more businesses in to where small businesses have vendor opportunities with those businesses. And part of our economic development process, let me just point out, is when we go out and we chase a deal, all of the marketing, all of the analysis that goes in, whose lease is expiring in 3 years, and we put together a package, right? We got to sell them on our state first, which is pretty easy compared to many of the pillars that I pointed out, that the great senator pointed out as well. Thankfully, we have a great regulatory, low regulatory, great business environment here in the state. But it takes more than that, because our competitors all around the country are giving more than that. So what I wanted to refer to was the survey that our members always pointed out, was that we needed to grow our economy. We needed more opportunities. And the last part of that economic development win, when you bring that company in, is you engage that company into the local community. You introduce them to those small business people. You introduce them to other corporate leadership. You introduce them to the elected officials. You engage them to where they are actively engaged in the Rotary Clubs. They're engaged in giving to nonprofit organizations, which many do. That's actually part of some agreements, that they must contribute to the local nonprofit community. And so the incentive that we give them, that we grant them, we get back tenfold.
But how much time did you spend working with the local government to reduce costs,
right,
so those small businesses and startups could become big businesses to support your
right
base? And at that growth level, you can adapt the infrastructure.
Sure.
That's right.
And that is the other piece of the supporting that second pillar that I mentioned, support entrepreneurs and small businesses.
But you spend who's this amount of time on it as opposed to this amount of time.
And I think that varies.
No, it doesn't.
And
no, it doesn't.
I certainly respect it, but I think that varies from city to city. We have to do a better job. I mean, think about all of the state programming, think about all the federal programming that we have that supports our small businesses. Is that incentivizing those small businesses?
All right, let's move on to Mr. Fletcher over here.
Yeah, Senator Hall said something that I was going to talk about, and I'll just I think reducing the eliminating the franchise
Absolutely.
tax,
Absolutely.
eliminating or reducing inventory taxes will make Texas a low cost destination for businesses. But something I haven't heard anybody talk about that troubles me, and why I don't think, even though I live just outside Austin, I don't think the Austin examples are good. Dallas-Fort Worth area and Houston area, what troubles me sometimes with economic development is, for example, in DFW, where you get Frisco competing against Bedford, let's say.
That's right.
A company that already has decided they're coming to the Dallas-Fort Worth area, and you've got two suburbs competing against each other. I just can't see how that's good for the Dallas-Fort Worth metropolitan area and for the state of Texas. And nobody's talked about that here today.
Yeah. Well, and that's a good point. Go ahead.
Just the competing of cities. You're just saying. Yeah. You've talked about competition. I've talked about how it's
like
bad.
Your manufacturer that's in your. So let's say Frisco is trying to, you know.
Right. That's why I say competition. To talk about competition at any level of government is bad, because you should not compete. Businesses should compete, yes, but governments should not compete. Because again, we're competing with the taxpayer dollars, and you're going to only get bigger and bigger and make worse decisions. And again, it's not how the market works. It's not supposed to be what drives businesses. It is supply and demand, supply and demand. And I'd like to, you know, with your point, because I thought this, I was like, have the chambers always, has this been their, you know, what is their job description, so to speak, you know, because I mean, I would rather them help a business on marketing your product, what's the best way to market it, what's, you know, those kinds of things, rather than always looking to the government to help these businesses, because again, it erodes the free market, and it's really none of their business, really, I don't think, and unless you were talking about taxes and regulation, that's about it.
Let me address those 2 points. The number one charge of a local chamber is lead generation. They have to generate leads for their members. Now, we may differ from chamber to chamber what time proportion they spend, and I certainly respect that, but that is the number one charge for any chamber of commerce in the entire country. Mitch Fletcher, you bring up some very good points. I agree with you, and TAB agrees with you. When it comes to cities, if a company is here, and they want to move from one city to the next city, I totally agree with you. What I'm talking about are incentives as part of an overall package, our toolkit, if you will, to bring new jobs, new companies into the state from the Californias, and they're coming in droves. Why are they coming?
Because why are they coming from New York? Low regulation and no income tax.
Part of it. But what if we didn't provide the incentives? Would they still come?
Yes.
Yes.
That's a question. Is
How
that
about we try it?
Is that a risk that we want to take? Is that a risk that we want to take? And I mean, that is a huge risk. But Mitch Fletcher, we totally are on the same track as far as a company that is here. And I experienced it far too many times in North Texas, that a company wants to move right across the county line to a different county, and they have a different taxing authority that can grant them incentives. That's where we need to draw the line, because that was not to my, and there's a lot of more experts in the room than myself that can answer that, but that was my intention, that was not the intent of the original statute to compete within the state. It is new jobs, new companies out of the state that are going to spur economic development growth in the state.
The one thing I want to add is the there was a mention of income tax. I'm in the oil and gas production business investment, so just shows you how stupid I am. and then I run a statewide nonprofit that only runs on donations, so I'm really stupid. But quite frankly, I would take a state income tax any day over the franchise tax, because I know a lot of businesses that aren't making money, and they're still getting taxed because it's on revenues.
Right.
I mean, I would gladly pay Pennsylvania. I do pay Pennsylvania's income tax, because I only pay it if I make a profit there. If I don't make a profit, I don't pay them anything.
Yeah. We're going to get the particularly the freshman senators that came in. This I will tell you, we are bound and determined to get rid of that franchise tax. Yeah. We tried to this past session and kind of ran into a wall. We even just wanted a glide path out on that franchise tax.
Absolutely.
We will be getting rid of that.
All right, we've got time for one more question, and then we're going to have to run. So,
if you think you're not smart, everybody wants to ask a question to get in the middle of these two of these panelists up here. Maybe not real smart, but clearly, I think what we've heard is the long-term impact of a favorable business environment for businesses operating in Texas is the best thing that government should concentrate on, not spending money and then accruing additional expenses. There are businesses, and the best example I think I can give is the NFL. You know, they go into a city, they build a stadium, wear it out, and then ask the next city to build them a bigger and better stadium. Mm-hmm. And if you just look at the engineers and all that goes around with that, and the engineers are out selling the next city on the package of rebates in order to move from that city to that city and take the game away, and Green Bay Packers are the only ones smart enough to figure it out, you just sell the franchise to the city or something. So they actually run the football game or something.
Goodness.
But, and they can't move it. But that's an example. And we all, so you don't want, somebody mentioned the word prostitution. I think it may be an analogy in there somewhere. But But at the same time, take the normal person. I'm running a big company. And we used to have to sometime move management around the country. And it's a very hard thing to dislodge management. You might talk to a nice salary for the manager you're trying to move, but his wife is involved with the local community, his children are involved in the local schools, et cetera. And so it's a hard thing to move. And you can imagine not moving just one executive, but moving an entire company somewhere. So not the prostitutes, if you will, but the companies that say, gee, I've looked at Texas, they are so smart. They have the best environment in the world. Mm-hmm. I think that where I am has gotten so onerous, I've got to leave. Right. I've got to make a decision. But there's this huge cost of uprooting and actually moving your business. So if there was some way to limit that somebody says, okay, if you make a decision to move here, we'll try to figure out how to cover your moving expenses to get here, but we're not going to give you any incentive beyond that because we're going to look at you to be a contributor to this economy. I don't know if that got discussed before I got in here or not, but I would say somebody's got to put, if there's anything, you got to put a cap on it. You can't just leave this open to where governments are competing with each other on how much of my taxpayer dollars had raised my house taxes 600% and I haven't moved and since 1989.
Okay. Well, we're going to have that be our last question and comment for the day. I really appreciate everybody being here today. If you're interested, the next panel on here is also from the Center for Economic Freedom. Kathleen Hunker, who works with me, is going to be having a panel on property rights and affordable housing and how we can make housing affordable for us all.
That's right.
Please join me in thanking one more time our panelists today.